ਦੇ ਟਾਈਮ ਵਿੱਚ ਬੜੀ ਪਿਆਰੀ ਜੀ ਨਾਸ ਸ਼ਰੀਫ ਜਿਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਕਿ ਅੱਗੇ ਹਮੇਸ਼ਾ ਪੜ੍ਹਦੇ ਨੇ ਉਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਦੇ ਨਾਸ ਸ਼ਰੀਫ ਪੇਸ਼ ਫਰਮਾਉਣ ਔਰ ਉਹਦੇ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਹਜ਼ਰਤ ਅਲਾਮਾ ਅਬਦੁਲ ਰਹਿਮਾਨ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਦਾ ਖਿਤਾਬ ਹੋਵੇਗਾ ਔਰ ਸਲਾਤ ਤਸਬੀਹ ਦਾ ਟਾਈਮ ਉਹਨੇ 12 ਦਾ ਦਿੱਤਾ ਸੀ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਥੋੜ੍ਹਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਅਗਰ ਅੱਗੇ ਪਿੱਛੇ ਕਰਨਾ ਪੈ ਜਾਵੇ ਤਾਂ ਮਹਿਸੂਸ ਕਰਨ ਦੀ ਜ਼ਰੂਰਤ ਨਹੀਂ ਇਨਸ਼ਾਅੱਲਾ ਤਾਲਾ ਅਜ਼ੀਜ਼ ਅੱਲਾ ਸਭ ਨੂੰ ਅਜਰੇ ਅਜ਼ੀਮ ਅਤਾ ਫਰਮਾਏ
ਮੁਨੱਵਰ ਹੁਸੈਨ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਜੀ ਦੀ ਫੋਟੋ ਵਿੱਚ Quality of shahna that grips our hearts. And sometimes the sad reality is that that animosity is towards our very own parents, towards our very own siblings, those who are living in the same household. And our houses have become literally like hotels, where we just check in and check out, but there's no communication amongst the families. And this is a widespread common problem that we are facing. And one of the causes of that is that we have this worldly ambition, this worldly, you know, attachment. We all become selfish, illa mashallah, except for those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved. And that selfishness leads to this great trait of shahna, of thinking about yourself so much that you disregard and you don't consider, give consideration to other people. That is one of the greatest diseases that Islam came to eliminate from this world, came to wipe away from this world. And the Prophet said that the time of Jahiliyyah will return to this Ummah, and that time of Jahiliyyah is the time, almost you could say, certain characteristics of that are widespread, and amongst those is the shahna that is preoccupying our hearts, when we look down upon other people. Look down upon other people because of maybe a certain caste they belong to, maybe a certain tribe they belong to, maybe they're from a different part of the country, maybe they're from a different part of the world, maybe they speak a different language, maybe they look different, maybe they're not to your own, you know, way of thinking. Whatever those differences are, because of those differences of people, the difference of states and appearances, we look down upon other people, and that looking down upon other people, sometimes elderly people are guilty of this, where they look down upon young people, no reason, the only reason is they're young. Okay, and they're older and they're young, and sometimes young people look down upon older people, no reason, the only reason is they don't get me, they don't understand what I'm going through. Okay, and they, because of being that age, is a reason for them to become full of hatred towards other people. This is the night that we have to be men. Okay, even the sisters, they have to rise up to becoming those that the Quran refers to as the Rijalullah, those who are the men of Allah. Who are the men of Allah? The men of Allah, those are the people of jihad. Not the type of jihad that the Taliban and Al-Qaeda are guilty of. That is fraud, that is nothing to do with jihad. The jihad that is against your egos. That ill feeling that you have in your heart, and that's preoccupying your heart, has been years and years that you have had that in your heart, that's stopping you from coming closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tonight is the night that you take it away and you throw it out of the window. You take that rancor away. Why? Because that grudge that you have for your fellow Muslim brother or sister, whatever the reason might be, ask yourself today, if on Yawm al-Qiyamah, let's say tonight is the last day you live in this world, and tonight, tomorrow you go, that's it, everybody's going to take your funeral, and that's it. Tomorrow you're standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you can see the paradise, just like you can see that hole there, the second hole, you can see paradise, literally, and you're so close to it. And then in the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down the angel saying, you have no access to this paradise. Why? Because you have a certain grudge that you had for a fellow Muslim brother and sister. Now you tell me, 10 years you had that grudge, 10 months you had that grudge, 10 weeks you had that grudge, was it worth it? Was it worth it? Was it worth it that you've been denied the ultimate happiness, never-ending happiness? And there's going to be people who go into Jannah and they get to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with their eyes. You will be deprived of that because of a grudge that you had over a certain matter of the world. Maybe it was because of fame reasons, popularity reasons, maybe it was because of wealth, maybe it was because of X, Y, Z, whatever that might have been, it's not worth it. There is no grudge that is so great in the world that is great for you to waste your hereafter over. Remember this sentence of mine. There is no grudge, there is no tension, there is no, you know, any type of ill feeling, negative feeling that is too big for you, too special for you to waste your hereafter over that certain grudge. Tonight is the night that you make peace with other people. You cannot truly make sulh, peace with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until you make peace amongst one another. Until you hold one another and say, you are my brother, I am your brother, you are my sister, I am your brother, I am your sister. Until you don't have that brotherhood and sisterhood, you can't make peace with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the other person will be deprived of the divine forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even on this night, even on this night, is the one who is the qadir, the one who cuts ties, the one who disconnects, who breaks people's lives apart. The one, you know, there's people who are married and who spread rumors, she spread rumors and gossip all over. Brightfield is, it's not small, but I'm saying it's very quick for rumors and gossip to go around. And because of that one rumor and gossip that is based upon baseless things, there's no proof for it whatsoever, a whole life has come to an end. A whole family is suffering because of that. And who's the guilty one? The one who thinks that he's going to go to Jannah, but we're not going to go anywhere near it because he's the Qatir. And the Prophet says about the Qatir, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْقَاطِعَ الْجَنَّةِ أَوْ قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The one who cuts ties, he will never go to paradise. He can be the greatest man that he is appearing to be. He can spread the whole, you know, life. He can make your i'tikaf in Ramadan. He can go to Hajj every year. He can make Umrah every year. But if he's guilty of breaking ties, if he's guilty of you know, breaking friendship, if he takes you away and you know, Muslims from each other, then that person, the Prophet, his pure lips, has uttered these words, that person has nothing to do with paradise. So tonight is a night that if we are guilty, if we know other people in our family members who are guilty, we try to give, offer them help, offer them this support. Tonight is a night that we need to get these ill feelings out of our heart. You know, once the companions, listen to this hadith, once the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were sitting together, just like you sitting together with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the next person to walk through the door is going to go straight to paradise. Next person to go through the door is going to go straight to paradise. The Sahaba thinking, what's so special about this next person? All eyes on the door. A man comes in. Just a normal person, just like neighbor. Nothing spectacular, appearance exactly the same. He comes and he sits down. The second day, the same majlis, and the same thing happens. The same man comes. The Prophet saying the person to walk to the paradise, through that door is going to go straight to paradise. He comes and he walks and he sits in the masjid. So there's some of the Sahabi, one of them got up, he goes, you know what, I'm going to go and see what's so special about this person that the Prophet of Allah has singled him out amongst all of the others. So he goes to this person and says, can I please spend a few moments with you, maybe a day or night or so, can I spend in your company just to see, you know, just to see how you do things. And he said, yeah, fair enough, you can come. So that person hosted him. He spent one day and one night in the company of this person. And he didn't see anything spectacular. After all of that, he said, you know what, the Prophet was sitting and he made this statement about you, but I haven't seen anything spectacular. I constantly read the same Quran that we read, it's the same amount that we read, the same the type of fasting, you know, the 5 daily prayers, it's exactly the same, there's nothing spectacular about you. So why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam single you out amongst all of the other companions? He says, you're right. There's nothing spectacular, but there is one thing that possibly could have been the ultimate reason that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave me the glad tidings of that Jannah. He said, what is it? He goes, never is there a night in my life except that when I go to sleep. And the meaning of what he said, every single person who has offended me throughout that day, every single person who's been abusive to me, who's been foul-mouthed, every person who's been racist, who has hurt my feelings in any shape or form, who has spread evil about me, whatever type, I get every single one of them and I forgive them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my heart, when I go to sleep, is free from any type of envy towards any of the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the Sahabi said, that is it. That is the reason that makes you so special in the sight of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we really want to be big people, let us revive the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sunnah of forgiving others for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, all of us sitting here right now, is there anybody who has experienced that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam experienced in his life as far as suffering is concerned? Can anybody stand up and say they have an uncle who was literally cut into pieces on the battlefield, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to his blessed body, and he was crying because he says that no, that everybody has somebody to cry over, but my uncle, Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, he had nobody to cry over him. Is there anybody who's been hurt like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? But what happened? That same Wahshi who was guilty of doing this filthy, vile and vulgar crime, that words can't even begin to explain. Okay, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he forgave him. When he came to the Prophet later on, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forgave him. And look what happened. Look at the wasila of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He knew, I'm not going to, if I shut the door on this person, that's the end for him. He left the door open, the door of mercy. Why? That same Wahshi who took the life of the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that same Wahshi, he served Islam in a most fascinating way. You know what he did? He was the person who was chosen to go out and fight Musaylimah. You know who Musaylimah was? The false prophet who claimed to be a prophet. He is the one who took the head off Musaylimah. And he served Islam in such a beautiful way. beautiful way, and he ended that fitna for her once and for all. Where did that start from? That started from the act of generosity, the act of forgiveness that the Prophet he gave out towards Wahshi. Had he not forgave him this great service of Islam, he would have been deprived of. So today somebody might have hurt your feelings, but I tell you, if you revive this sunnah of the Prophet, tomorrow at a certain time might come that that person might end up becoming your ticket to paradise. Your ticket to paradise. You don't know. This is the system, the way Allah has created things. Okay, the same woman who chewed upon the liver of Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, the Prophet forgave her for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of these beautiful examples, those who wanted to take the life of the Prophet and others, all of those who were forgiven by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because he came as an example as to how not to have shahna, how not to have these ill feelings in your heart towards fellow humans, no matter what they have done to you, no matter what they have done to you, no matter what they are thinking of doing to you. Sometimes they haven't done anything. It's all in your mind that they are thinking. And the Quran gives us a very beautiful ayah. Take this ayah. And this is like the legacy of Sha'ban, the legacy of the 15th night of Sha'ban. The Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that thing which you have no knowledge of, don't pursue it. You don't know something, so why are you assuming something? And then based upon that assumption, you are reacting to things or reacting to things and making a response that is completely blown out of proportion. If you don't have concrete knowledge of something, forget about it. It's as though it doesn't even exist. Okay, if you can take this one ayah, if you can truly apply this in your life, I promise you there's so many different types of suffering that you yourself can be saved from, and also you can have your families released from the shackles of those different types of pain and suffering. Forget about it. Conspiracies, assumptions, all of these things that are blown out of proportion has nothing to do with Islam, nothing to do with the way of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. So the second of the group of people who are deprived of the mercy of Allah tonight is the one who is the qadir, the one who cuts ties. And the third group of people, and this is the one that are very, very difficult, especially in this day and age, especially living in England. Because back home, you know, when people last, the generation previous to us, its life was very simple. You didn't have these gadgets. You know, these gadgets that have come in. You had none of these, a very simple life. So you had less distractions, people would stay at home. And it was a very homely atmosphere. But the culture that we live in, everybody's outgoing. Everybody has become, you know, we're guilty of something that's referred to as individualism, where we want everything to be based upon what I want, what I think, what I, me. So because of that, what has happened is, the children have a certain image that they portray of parents. And likewise, because of that, the reaction has been, the parents also are suffering because they don't have any clue as to what is happening with their own children. And because of that, we're seeing a culture where there is a gap that is emerging between parents and between children. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that those group of people who will be denied the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tonight are those who are guilty of uququl walidain. Those who are guilty of disobeying their parents. If any one of you is sitting here, for whatever reason, I know it's tough. I know it's tough. It's not easy. Especially sometimes you could be more religious and more practicing than your parents. It could happen. But that father of yours sometimes, excuse me for saying this, he just doesn't understand. And the reality is, the next 20 years, he might still never get you. But the thing that your child, this is, you have to understand, this is my greatest jihad. Allah has chosen you to make that greater jihad. People are going out there and they are, you know, blowing themselves up. They're going straight to hellfire because of doing that. But look at how Allah loves you. He's chosen you to make jihad within your own home, where you have to come in every single day and you have to put up with this elderly father, elderly mother of yours who has no in-laws, or it could be your siblings. Okay, you have no understanding of who you are, whatever reason, you have fallen out and you have to treat. Those wounds are so, you know, deep in your heart, they are very difficult to heal. And you have to cope with that. You can't tell anybody as well. There's nobody to turn to and to tell them, look, this is the way I feel about my father or by my mother or by my elders. But Allah is there for you tonight. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there for you every night. And this is the night that you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you take your heart to Allah and you say, oh Allah, my wounded heart, there is nobody who can cure it. There's nobody who can heal it except for you. You are the Muqallibul Qulub, you are the Musarriful Qulub. So tonight is a night that you take that heart and you try your best to put up with whatever difficulties that you have to experience from your parents. Because the greatest talent is living with your parents and trying to cope even with those differences. Take it from this point of view, it is your greatest jihad, you just have to put up with it. There's one of two options, either you just leave it and run away from it, it doesn't solve anything. It might just make things more messed up and more of a crisis for you. The other way is you be the way a believer should be and you deal with it, whatever those differences are, hear them from one ear, you know, throw them out of the other, as we say in our culture. Okay, cope with it, learn. Go to those people, sit in the company of those people who can inspire you to do that, who walk the same walk as you. Okay, who walk the same path, they know how you feel. There's so many brothers and sisters out there who can help you. So once inshallah you do all of these things, and we hope you will find the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this night. So this is a night, and coming back to, it's a night of forgiveness. It's a night of seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tonight, every single one of you, don't leave this masjid except that you have sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the most important thing that you need to do tonight. And that is a recognition that I am the most sinful person on this planet. If you can really have that about yourself, that I am the most sinful person, really believe that, okay, that will lead to openings that are beyond your imagination, that your mind cannot fathom. Tonight is the night to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make dua, okay, recite to the Yasin, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make those openings for you. But whatever you do, guys, don't waste it. You know what happens normally is, I'll finish with this, what happens normally is, many of us, we don't really make dua. A whole lifetime goes, and there's many people still sitting here. The only time you make dua, and you be honest with yourself, is when Shah Sahib or anybody, Imam Sahib is making the dua, and you say, Ameen to the dua. True? You say, Ameen to the dua. But when have you actively made dua where you are all alone? You and Allah alone, that is it. And you are crying in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are saying the dua, and the angels are being sent from the heaven to say, Ameen to your dua. When have you done that? That is the sunnah that I would like you to revive tonight. Okay, open up your heart to Allah. Tell Him, ask Him, request from Him tonight, and He will open up. And He will. You know, there's so many people I know in my life whose lives changed because of this night. This night of Laylatul Nisr in Sha'ban, they were at home, and the mom said, oh, you know, they were fed up with them. The mom said, do something good for one. Just go to the masjid. Get out of there, okay? The mom pushed them, they came to the masjid, and they came, and Wallahi al-Azim, I say, halfan, their life changed forever. People I can mention, their whole life, previously there was something else, and then from that day, they became something else. The power of this dua, don't deprive yourself of the blessing of this dua, turn to Him. La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Make this prayer, whatever, istighfar, whatever you can do tonight, but don't let it go to waste, and continue with this great, the blessings after the 15th night of Sha'ban throughout Ramadan as well. There's so much to offer, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so much to share. But I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq to be of those people who truly, wholly experience the blessings of this night, and who truly and wholly embrace the legacy of this night, and who truly and wholly go out and share the blessings and the legacy of this night, so that inshallah ta'ala, we can be of those people who are the worthy recipients of the blessings, and not those people who are the denied and the deprived ones. Everybody conclude by saying Ameen. وما علي إلا البلاغ وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ما وأهله وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم برحمتك يا رب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ایک دو ایران اسماء فرما لگو ایک دن ایک ਤੁਹਾਨੂੰ ਪਤਾ ਫਰਾਈਡੇ ਵੀ ਜੁਮੇ ਦੇ ਮੌਕੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਸਾਡੀ ਗੌਸੀਆ ਮਸਜਿਦ ਨੈਲਸਨ ਦੇ ਅਹਬਾਬ ਫੰਡ ਰੇਜ਼ਿੰਗ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਆਪਣੀ ਮਸਜਿਦ ਦਾ ਚੁੱਕੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਕੰਮ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ ਕਰਵਾਇਆ ਹੈ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਉਹ ਤਸ਼ਰੀਫ ਸਾਡੀ ਮਸਜਿਦ ਵਿੱਚ ਲਿਆ ਰਹੇ ਨੇ ਜਿਸ ਵਕਤ ਜੁਮਾ ਪੜ੍ਹਨ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਅਹਬਾਬ ਤਸ਼ਰੀਫ ਲਿਆ